Hi guys, and welcome back to my channel. You guys, I'm just choosing, you guys already know, it is because it is another movie review, which honestly, I always say they're the hardest to film for me, but once they're uploaded and you guys are interacting with me, they're the most fulfilling and satisfying. So today we have The Jungle Book. Without further ado, let's get into the movie. Yeah, I was so excited to review this movie, especially right now in my life. It's holding some weight, honey. It is very, very important to me. So when I saw what's next to come up on my movie review, I was like, let's get into this. I will say, a lot of these movie reviews that I've been doing for you guys, I haven't watched those movies. Maybe I watched them once and I didn't remember them. The Jungle Book, I remember the music more so than anything. I didn't really remember the plot at all. And then I recently, last year, watched the live action. And for some reason, when I watched this movie again, well, like a week ago, it's as if I never watched the movie. So when I usually tell you guys my first time watching, I very much mean either it is truly my first time watching it, like The Aristocrats is coming up soon, I really have never watched that movie, or it is truly my first time watching it through adult lenses. So obviously my perspective and thoughts on the movie will be completely different than when I was a child. For this movie, it actually debuted in 1967 and it got an 88% on Rotten Tomatoes. So this movie starts off in India. That is something, when I tell you, that went over my head. I don't know where I thought this movie took place, but I did not think it was India. I actually thought it was Africa. I thought it was very like Tarzan-y. Is Tarzan like South Africa? I feel like it is. But I did not know this was in India. And of course, the scene opens and we meet baby Mowgli. Am I saying that right? Don't come for me throughout this movie if I get people's names wrong. It's okay. We get it. You're an expert. I am not. So the scene opens and we see a little baby crying, which is Mowgli, right? And then kind of like, I think Bagheera is the lion, or ooh, is Bagheera a panther or something like that? Oh gosh. It's a fictional panther. Okay, a black panther. Hey, black panther. So Bagheera is a black panther that we see in the beginning of the scene. And I think Bagheera honestly narrates this whole movie. But we meet Bagheera, and one of the scenes, and I have it written down, one of the quotes that Bagheera says, which stands out to me, you guys know I'm a huge quote person. And so Bagheera says, had I known how, so Bagheera is like looking at this baby cry, right? There's this like random baby crying in the neck of the jungle. There's a baby crying in the jungle, like a random baby crying in the neck of the jungle, right? And so Bagheera literally says, had I known how deeply I was to be involved, I would have obeyed my first impulse and walked away. How many of us is that in life? Like, yo, if I would have known, if I had known how deeply I'd been involved, I would have left. It wasn't for me. Bagheera's kind of like inspecting this baby and was like, yo, like this baby's cute and all, but I cannot take care of this baby. I don't got no kids. And so he was like, okay, you know what? There's some wolves that I know that literally just had a whole bunch of little cubs. So like maybe they know how to take care of kids. So I'm going to drop this baby Mowgli off to like the nearby pack of wolves. Scary. So Bagheera ends up dropping off Mowgli like right in the middle of these wolves and like dips, runs away, kind of peers through like the bushes to see what happens. And the wolves do like kind of surround the baby, like, what is this? What is this weird flesh plumpness over here? And the thing is, Bagheera wasn't scared of like the mother wolf, but he was like, the father wolf, I'm a little skeptical, because I don't know, he didn't know if the father wolf would like be receptive to Mowgli. But it turns out the mom, the kids, the father, they all love them some Mowgli, and it actually worked out perfectly. Like, they ended up raising this boy. Also, side note, I don't know if they ever mentioned the wolf, the mother wolf's name, but they did mention the dad's name. The dad wolf's name is Rama, but I don't think they ever like mentioned the woman's name. The next scene cuts to like 10 years go by, right? And now Mowgli is no longer like a little toddler, a little infant. He's now like a 10-year-old boy running with the pack of wolves, which is his family. And Bagheera's like always nearby, always kind of looking over him. You guys know how I talk about everyone in Disney movies have protectors. It's either fairies or anything like that. Well, for Mowgli, it is Bagheera. Again, I tell you, you look close enough in these movies, you get a Jiminy Cricket, you get a Blue Fairy, you get a Fairy Godmother, you get a Rafiki. This one you get Bagheera. Bagheera does notice, like, you know, Mowgli is taken care of. He's having the time of his life. But the thing is, he lives in the jungle. So let's be real. That cannot last forever. Like, this sounds really mean, but it's kind of what the whole basis of this storyline was, is like, he wasn't with his kind. And so like, you not being with your kind can't last forever. That was kind of like this part of the movie. Like, very like, we don't talk about those things. Like, what do you mean you're kind? Like, what is your kind, right? But that's let's be real. So he also, like, the one reason why he really was like, yo, Mowgli cannot live this life forever is because there is a vicious lion named Shere Khan, I forget. And this lion, like, does not like humans. Like, he hates humans, fire, and everything. Which, because you understand the relationship between humans and the jungle, right? Like, they hunt their hunters and stuff like that. And so, obviously, like, he's probably seen his loved ones, or he's probably grown up with, like, these tales of how humans have, like, really killed off his, like, father, his mother, his grandfather, his papa. Like, there's a reason why he feels this way. So it's not like when you hear this, you're like, oh wow, this lion's tripping. It's like, I get it. But it's also like, what he did was prejudge that every human has those same intentions, right? So there's a scene where all the wolves meet up at this place called Council Rock. Get it? And they're really discussing, like, yo, we heard through the grapevine that the vicious lion, whatever, Shere Khan, is back in these neck of the woods, jungle. And they were like, you know what, you know how much Shere Khan hates humans, so Mowgli is not gonna last here. And like, if he does, that's gonna put us in danger, because you know Shere Khan's gonna come for Mowgli, and that puts the rest of the pack in danger. So they all came up with an agreement, like, yo, somebody gotta tell Rama, the father wolf, that's cute that you tried to foster this boy, but he gotta go, because if he stays, that puts the rest of the pack at risk. So Akela is the leader of the pack of wolves. Akela tells Rama, hey, you know, your son cannot live here, cannot be here anymore. And Rama's like really hurt. He's like, yo, this is basically a son to me. Like, I'm sure, like, if he's a son to me, I'm sure he's entitled to the protection of the pack the same way my kids would be. Akela agrees and was like, he is, like, entitled to the protection of the pack. But the thing is, all of us in the pack are still no match for the strength of Shere Khan. So, like, it's just a lose-lose situation, my brother. Rama's sitting there, like, kind of like, dude, like, what do I do? Like, Mowgli cannot survive by himself in the jungle. And then Bagheera's like a nosy ass panther, and he's just always, like, lurking around. But thankfully he was, because he kind of, like, jumps down from a tree, overhears the conversation, and is like, hey, Rama, I, like, always go on trips with Mowgli throughout the jungle. I teach him things. Kind of like, in a way, Bagheera's very much like a godfather, in my sense, to Mowgli. Like, he always looks after him. He was the one that first discovered him, so he really keeps an eye on him. And he's like, look, I've shown this boy, like, he trusts me. He walks through the jungle with me every day, so I will take him to a nearby man village where I know he'll be better off. And I know he'll come with me to this man village because we've walked through the jungle all the time. So he won't have no hesitations with going with me. So the next scene is Bagheera walking with Mowgli, and Mowgli's like, yo, like, we're kind of walking far, like, where are we going? And, you know, basically Bagheera has to be like, yeah, I'm sorry, buddy, like, you're not going back to your wolf pack, you're not going back to your family, you got to go to another place, you're not safe here because of Shere Khan. He basically breaks down the whole thing for him, and Mowgli's like, I don't understand, like, he doesn't know me, like, I know he don't like man, but, like, I'm not like that. And he's like, there is no explaining to Shere Khan, you know, you as a man in his eyes regardless, like, there is no explaining. And I feel like a lot of us do this, like, we get grouped into, like, what people think about us, and we're like, no, but I'm not like that. And at some point it's just like, you don't even have to explain yourself. Like, if people see you a certain way, they're gonna see you that way. And I don't feel like for us it's like, I don't feel like we sometimes need to carry the burden of over-explaining ourselves or, like, trying to stand out from, like, what we're characterized as. It's like, as long as you know in your heart who you are, you don't need to be explaining to people. Because sometimes you can try to explain to people, but if they want to be ignorant and closed-minded, they will be, regardless of everything that you try to do. Like, it's just not going to change anything. So at this point, they've been traveling a long time, and they, like, go to this little tree to sleep. So Bagheera's sleeping. He's telling Mowgli, like, all right, go to sleep. Like, you're annoying. Because honestly, Mowgli is very annoying throughout this movie. Like, he's a little kid that always thinks he knows best and thinks that what adults are doing for him is not the best. In turn, it's not that. It's like, adults around us sometimes have to make the hard decisions that we cannot make, but it doesn't mean that we don't love you, kind of thing. So while Bagheera is asleep, Mowgli is, like, just fiddling in the tree, and then Ka the snake comes down. And as you guys know, if you've seen it, you know Ka is, like, this hypnotizing, sneaky-ass snake slithering, and comes slithering in talking like, oh, like, I'm trying to, not, he doesn't say I'm trying to hypnotize you, but basically the goal is to hypnotize Mowgli so, like, he could be eaten. Bagheera wakes up right on time, saves Mowgli, Ka goes on his or her slithering way, and that whole scene ends. The next scene is, like, again, I tell you guys always, if I don't feel like a scene is important to me, I skip over it, darling. So there is a scene where there's, like, all these elephants. It's like the Dawn Patrol, and it's like a herd of elephants. It's just not important to me. So it's the next day and it's time for Mowgli to go on his way with Bagheera, right? And Mowgli, like I said, Mowgli is so annoying. So he keeps like just fighting, like, I don't want to go. I don't want to go. I can take care of myself in the jungle. And like, honestly, I was with Bagheera at this point. Like, bro, if you want to do what you want to do, fine. Like, I'm not going to force you. Like, you want to, you think you know what's best? You think you can defend yourself in the jungle? Have at it, baby boy. Do it. Do it. Do it. It's not my problem anymore. You're no longer my problem. So while Bagheera leaves, funny enough, Mowgli ends up bumping into the beloved Baloo, which is a huge, big old bear. My love, Baloo. I really love Baloo, you guys. Sometimes I wait to the end to tell you who I love. But like at this point in my Disney journey, it's like sometimes I can't hide my love for characters. And so far, it's no secret that I do love, well, you know what's funny? At this part, I started like I had loved Bagheera already. But the more and more I get to know Baloo's personality and like what sacrifices he was willing to do for Mowgli within knowing him for only like a couple of hours, it kind of took away a little bit of my love for Bagheera, which is crazy, and I'll try to explain at the end. But anyways, Mowgli meets Baloo along the way, which is like this really cool bear. And this bear just like, Mowgli at first was like, get away from me. I don't want to talk to you. Like, stop punking me. And then Baloo's like, what, you trying to fight me? All right, let's fight, kid. Like, put your fist up. Let's fight. And then they both kind of like do this little jab thing. And Baloo's trying to teach him how to be a fighter. And it was cute because it turned into like Mowgli really thinking like, I'm going to defend myself. And then realizing that Baloo's really just trying to teach him how to defend himself. And it comes into like, you know, just kind of like how a father like teaches his boy how to like be a man and like put your fist up, don't let nobody hit you, don't let nobody punk you. And I thought that was really, really cute. It's funny because while Baloo and Mowgli are like play fighting, like I forget who lets out a yell, but it wasn't like I'm an injured yell, it was just kind of like a, oh dang, like you got me. And Bagheera hears it, and Bagheera's like, aha, like he finally got himself in trouble. He runs back to the scene only to see Mowgli fighting with Baloo, like play fighting. You could tell at this part Bagheera actually knows Baloo, probably knows his reputation, knows that he means no harm, and was like, oh man, he finally met Baloo the bear, like, okay. And Mowgli was like, basically like, I ain't scared of nobody, or I ain't no punk, or something like that. And what I loved was at this part, this is when you knew really Baloo's like true intentions to Mowgli. He goes, you better believe it. Like, I don't know, you guys have to watch this part, but it was, well, let me think of what were the exact words. Mowgli says, I'm stronger than people think. And then Baloo goes, you better believe it. And it's just like, anything that Mowgli thinks of himself, like Baloo's like, I'm right behind you. Like, I already know about you, bro. Like, I got your back. And that was a very, very telling time of like, this is not even an ally, like this is someone that like believes in you, kind of like how your parents do, like your parents are gonna believe in you the way you believe in yourself type thing. And I don't know, I was just like, oh my god, I love me some Baloo. And I this part, I don't think I can, I'm worried because I think the amount of videos, the amount of movies I have reviewed at this point, and the amount of characters I've fallen in love with is concerning. Cause like my collection's getting bigger and it shouldn't be. Okay, let's continue. The next part, obviously, like I said, Baloo and Mowgli are really starting to like each other. They're like kind of getting this really cute friendship. Then it breaks out into Bare Necessities, the most famous song of this whole movie and very much up there in Disney history. So I'm gonna play a little clip for you now.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities are Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.
So as always, if something stands out to me, I let you guys know. Bare Necessities, there is a part, there's a lyrics in this song that I wanted to kind of talk to you guys about. So it basically says, if you act like the bees act, you're working too hard. And don't spend your time looking around for something you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it, I'll tell you something true. The bare necessities of life will come to you. Basically, how I took that is, instead of worrying yourself, instead of doing the absolute freaking most, getting yourself worked up, overthinking, overdoing, chill out. Chill out. And when you realize everything that I'm worrying about is not needed, like my worrying is not needed to fix the situation, I'ma just chill. Then it will come to you. Then everything will fall into place. Only when you stop buzzing, you stop doing the most, and you realize that what you are worrying about doesn't actually require worrying. Let me read it one more time for you guys. If you act like the bees act, you're working too hard. And don't spend your time looking around for something you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it, I'll tell you something true. The bare necessities of life will come to you. Oh, wow. Wowzers. All right. So after this really cute scene, of course, there's the beautiful, like, it's kind of like an artistic scene where Baloo is floating through the water and then Mowgli is sitting on top of his stomach. It's just like, that is such an iconic picture. That whole scene is just iconic, right? But after this, while they're kind of like minding their business, going along the stream, monkeys actually like come over top, kidnap Mowgli before Baloo even notices. After Baloo actually notices that Mowgli has been taken by some crazy ass monkeys, he like screams for help. Bagheera actually comes to his aid and is like, what happened? He was like, yo, like, I think they kidnapped Mowgli. And he's like, I thought you was the bear. I thought you had it all under control. I thought you and Mowgli knew how to do the damn thing. Like, you still need my help. Like, no matter what, y'all always need my help. So it's like, Bagheera, ain't nobody trying to hear you. Like, either you're trying to help or not. Like, I hate people like that. That's like, oh, now you need my help. Like, yeah. Remember, this whole movie, this whole part of the scene is this little boy is supposed to be on his way to the man village. And like, he meets Baloo on the way. They have a little dandy adventure. Now he gets kidnapped by some monkeys. And now he finds himself in King Louis's penthouse. You know what I'm talking about. In his neck of the woods, honey. And King Louis is a mood. King Louis is a vibe. He is a whole mood. I will tell you though, a lot of people have said to me, oh, they love King Louis more in the animated film. I love King Louis more in the live action. Oh my God. King Louis's personality, like his accent and that whole thing and like his massive appearance really, really comes through in the live action. So if you have not watched the live action, make sure to go do so. In the animated, he doesn't come off as like, hoo, hoo, hoo. Like, yo, in the live action, like it scared the hell out of me. I was like, dang, King Louis and his accent and everything. But basically, King Louis is like this huge alpha ape. And he has Mowgli kidnapped, and he's like, yo, you're a little man, you're a man, right? And the thing is, King Louis is tired of monkeying around. He's tired of playing around. He wants to be a man. He wants to be like the men in the world. And he's really particularly fascinated by fire. So he starts singing out, I want to be like you, right? I want to be like you. And I'll go ahead and play the song now.
And be just like the other men. I'm tired of monkeying around. Oh, ooby-doo. I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Talk like you.
Basically, yes, the song is meaning like, I want to be like man, basically. And that whole thing, he's trying to bargain like, yo, you show me how fire works and I'll hook you up, maybe get you out of here or whatever. But remember, like, although Shere Khan believes that Mowgli's a man, a typical man, this boy really don't know nothing about the wildlife. He doesn't know nothing about fire. He doesn't know nothing about humans. So he literally cannot help King Louis because he's like, you want to know about fire? I do too. I don't know nothing about it. Maybe we can find out together. That's no use for King Louis. But right on time, Bagheera and Baloo come in and try to like rescue him. Basically, there is this whole scene, as you can imagine. King Louis ain't trying to give him up, so all King Louis and his monkeys try to like fight Baloo, Bagheera, and Mowgli, but they somehow get away. And the next scene is, you know, finally they're like, whew, man, we done fought off the whole freaking jungle at this point. So they put Mowgli to sleep, and then Bagheera calls Baloo to the side like, yo, I need to talk to you, okay? You want to come up in our lives? We need to have a talk. So Bagheera's basically like, look, Mowgli obviously is fond of you. He takes to you. You need to bring him to the man village. Like, if you really love this boy, you need to do what's best for him. And Baloo really shoots back real quick, like without hesitation, without thinking about it. He's like, I'll do anything for that boy. Like, I love him like he's my own cub. And I'm like, wow, Mowgli is so loved, because not only did Baloo say that, but Rama said that in the beginning too. Like, when Akela was saying like, yo, like he can't stay here with the wolf pack, he was like, this is like my own son. And so I'm like, this is the second time, probably the third time, because I'm sure Bagheera has thought it too, but like, there's a lot of older men that really take to Bagheera, or that really take to Mowgli, and really do care about his protection. Bagheera basically was like, I know you love him, like you said, you love him. And Baloo's like, I'll do anything for him. He was like, cool, then do what's best for him. Don't think about yourself, do what's best for Mowgli and bring him back to the town. And he's like, all right, fine. And the thing that's hard about it is Baloo had promised Mowgli, like, that he could stay with him. Like, oh, you know what? You don't want to go back to the man. You don't want to go back to the man village. You can stay with me. I'll take care of you in the jungle. But it was at this point where I think Baloo kind of got a taste of, like, how vulnerable this kid was in the jungle and how much, like, people really wanted him and, like, so many people, like, were out to get him that, like, he alone could really not, he couldn't really protect him on his own. So the best thing to do was break this little boy's heart, but eventually do what's best for him and deliver him to the man village. There is a point, I believe, Baloo goes and tells Mowgli, like, hey, Mowgli, I love you, but I gotta take you home. And, like, don't kill me or don't hate me or anything, but, like, I gotta do what I gotta do. And Mowgli, of course, is like, Bagheera turned on him. Now, you know, Baloo's turning on him, so he runs away. He's like, I can't trust none of y'all. I said I want to stay in the jungle. I said I didn't want to go to this man village, so he dips. And obviously, Bagheera hears about this because Baloo tells him. Whew, there's a lot of names in this film. And so I think there's this part where, you know, that herd of elephants that I told you in the beginning, it just wasn't that big of a deal to me. So Bagheera is talking to the elephants and he's like, hey, can you help us find Mowgli? Like, he's gone missing. He's by himself out here in the jungle. Of course, the sneaky Shere Khan is actually listening to this conversation in the woods. He's kind of like hiding in some bushes and he hears that Mowgli is by himself in the jungle and is like, let's go to work. There's this part where Mowgli's by himself in the jungle, kind of walking around, and gets met by Ka the snake again. Ka comes down trying to talk to him, trying to hypnotize him again. And right when he's like about to, Shere Khan comes in. And so I don't know how, but like the snake kind of like wraps Mowgli in like his arms or something so he wouldn't be hidden. Because I think the thing is, like, it wasn't that Ka was trying to protect Mowgli. It was like Ka was trying to protect Mowgli for him or herself and didn't want Shere Khan to get him because he knew that's what he was after. And Shere Khan's like, have you seen Mowgli? And he was like, no. Shere Khan was like, are you sure? Like, you wouldn't be hiding nothing from me, right? He's like, I've never seen that little kid in my life. Never a day in my life have I seen him. And he was like, all right, cool. Like, thanks. I appreciate it. Well, when you do, make sure to bring him to me. He was like, cool. Eventually, Mowgli's like, you just a Slytherin snake. You just phony and sneaky. And he dips off from Ka's, like, grasp and runs away. This kid is always on the run. Let me tell you, if it was me, I would have been tired. I think I would have just chilled with King Louie and be like, what to do, what it is. I'm tired. The next scene is Mowgli walking through the jungle, and he's like walking real slow at this point because he has nobody on his side anymore. He ran away from Baloo, he ran away from Bagheera. He's just alone. He's kind of probably like, okay, I can't go back to my wolf pack family. These freaking apes tried to kidnap me. There's this Ka snake ass snaky snake that keeps trying to hypnotize me. This big papa of Shere Khan's trying to eat my life. Baloo a damn liar. Bagheera's a damn liar. And then I don't want to go to the man village. Like, it's a lot. You just feel a lot of like neglect, like a lot of abandonment, right? So he's sitting there just like walking all slow. And then there's these vultures that like see him and they're like, oh, look at this little sad little boy. And they go over there kind of like making fun of him, like, oh my god, look at his feet and whatever. And let me tell you what this scene is. It's very much Dumbo, where the crows in Dumbo, at the end of Dumbo, they were trying to make fun of his ears. They realized they were going too far because Jiminy was like, oh, Jiminy, look, I'm so obsessed. It was Timothy Mouse, right? I think Timothy Mouse was like, yo, pick on somebody your own side. Like, this boy is crying, he's sad. And then remember that part in Dumbo, the crows ended up being nice to him and helped him discover he could fly. Very much same thing in this scene. The vultures were like, oh man, damn, like, you really sad, like, no, don't be sad. And they really sing, I forget the song, but it's a song about like being happy and like, you know, they try to make him like an honorary vulture and like, yo, like, everything's good in your life, and they try to bring a smile on his face. And the funny part is, I'm gonna make it up because I don't remember the song, but basically there's a part where they're singing like, let me make it up, it's like, let's be happy, and then Shere Khan comes out of nowhere and is like, very happy. Like, I found you. Basically, it was like, I found you. And what about it? I don't know why, but that was like one of the first times in Disney history where I was like, that was pretty smooth. So of course, Shere Khan enters the chat, right? Shere Khan is there for one thing and one thing only. Mowgli dead equals success. So of course, Shere Khan's going after Mowgli, and perfect timing, Baloo and Bagheera actually show up. Actually, darling, Bagheera does not show up. Baloo does. Baloo shows up, right? Yeah, Baloo shows up. Baloo actually ends up fighting Shere Khan. Shere Khan doesn't die. They just kind of get in like a tumble match, and Shere Khan kind of like bounces off into the wind one way, and Baloo takes a pretty hard hit as well. But at the end, like, the vultures are like really happy, like, woohoo, like, you're saved. Bagheera comes out of nowhere after this whole fiasco goes down, and it looks like, so the vultures are like really happy that it's done, right? They're like singing like, woohoo, it's cool, Mowgli is safe, he's standing next to Bagheera. But then you look over and you see Baloo is like kind of hunched over because he took a real bad hit when he was fighting with Shere Khan. And Bagheera is so shady in this part, because first of all, where were you? But second, he just starts doing this like, oh, what greater sacrifice than for one to lay down their life for their friend. We will always remember our dearly beloved Baloo. Something like that, right? And then Mowgli's crying because they literally believe Baloo to be dead. And Baloo is like hurt, right? But he's not dead. So he's listening to this like sad speech being given to him by Bagheera. And he's like, dang, I wish my mother was here to hear this. And then he like literally wakes up and he tells Bagheera like, can you keep going? That was really good. And Bagheera's like, bro, you was awake this whole time. And so it shows like they kind of go off fighting, and it shows their dynamic of like, how you gonna have me sit there and do a whole funeral thing for you when you was alive? And he was like, it was real cute. That was really touching. But seriously, Bagheera was real shady. Like, where were you? Like, you came perfect timing just to say your like good riddance to Baloo. I don't know. That's what I'm saying. In the beginning, I loved Bagheera, but at the end, I was like, you a little shady. So, of course, Mowgli's super excited that Baloo was not dead. He runs over to Baloo. He's like, oh my god, you're not dead. And then Baloo literally says, like, the cutest line. He's like, I was just taking a five, you know, playing it cool. You guys know what I'm talking about. Like, maybe if you've ever had someone, like, especially like a father figure where you like thought you were gonna lose them, and they say something where it's kind of like, you remember who I am, like, I'm your dad, or I'm your uncle, or I'm your brother, like, you know, nothing's gonna take me out. You know how sentimental that part was. So I was just taking a five, you know, playing it cool. Like, I love Baloo. Also, help me understand if you can, but there is a vibe with King Louie, especially in the live action. King Louie comes off as like this New York type of guy. You know what I'm saying? Like, he comes out like a New Yorker. But there is a vibe with Baloo, and I can't put my finger on it. So please, 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 for the life of me, let me know down below what vibe Baloo is supposed to give off. Please. At the end, Baloo gets up, hugs Mowgli. They kind of like walk off into the sunset. It's not the end. It's not the very, very end. But Baloo says to Mowgli, nothing will ever separate us again. And I was like, man, that's so cute. And then while they're like walking off into the sunset, Bagheera's like somewhere doing his own thing. Like, he's behind them, like walking real slow, giving them their moment. There's this little girl that's like getting some water, very much like Feline and Bambi moment, but she's like getting some water, and then Mowgli's like, who the heck is you? What is that? What is that? Remember, he's never seen man before, let alone a female, and she was gorgeous. So he's like, what is that? And then Baloo's basically like, oh no, those things, stay away from them, they trouble. You don't need to know them. And he's like, I never seen one before. He's like, you've seen them now, we good, you ready to go? Let's go. Like, we're not doing this. I'm definitely not losing you to a girl. Like, that's what's not gonna happen. And so the girl smiles at Mowgli, and you guys know what I'm talking about. Hopefully I can find a picture. She smiles at Mowgli. Mowgli's so freaking weird and like just weird. He does a smirk instead. He goes, I can't do it. It's like, ah, it's like a little thing with his nose, like I'll hopefully have a picture for you. But he does it back to her. He also did this when the vultures were singing a song about happiness. He did it. It was like something about be happy, and Mowgli's like, I can't do it. It's like something with his nose where he's like this. He does it again to the girl. The girl does a little like wink wink with her nose too, kind of saying like, you have a weird grin, I'll do a little nose thing with you, you could be weird with me, type of thing. So the girl does peep Mowgli, and she's like, okay, remember I said she was drawing water from the pond, not the pond, like a nearby river. And she sees him and she's like, okay, how am I gonna get him to like talk to me? So she drops her bucket. Oops. Mowgli goes after it and was like, okay, and he puts it on top of his head, and he like goes after her with it, like walking after her, and it's like he's leading himself into the man village. So I think this goes back to the Bare Necessities song. don't look for it, don't think about it, but somehow at the end, it's still, like, you still arrive at your destination the perfect way. Like, he ends up, okay, well, let me not jump ahead. So basically, he has his water bucket in his head. He looks back at Bagheera and Baloo, kind of like, can I go? Can I go into this man village and do my life? Of course, this is Bagheera's whole mission, the, you know, the whole time. So he like, go. Baloo's like, come back. Boy, if you don't come back here and stay with your father. And basically, so Baloo's like, come here. And then Bagheera's like, go on. So come here, go on. They're doing that. Mowgli follows the girl into the village. So it's very much, again, like bare necessities. The whole point was to get this boy into the man village. He didn't want to go to the man village, but it's like perfect timing. This girl is placed there. She leads him in. It's not even that someone had to drag him in. He wants to go. It all works out. You just don't even got to think about it. Like, life's path will bring you to where you need to be regardless. It's the bare necessities. So at the end, Bagheera and Baloo, like, Baloo finally is like, yeah, I guess it was bound to happen. And Bagheera's like, exactly. And so he holds arms with Bagheera and they walk into the sunset, back into the jungle where they belong. And they're just singing, it's the bare necessities. Forget about your worry and your strife. So literally, it's like, at the end of the day, everything works out. Forget about your worries. Don't ponder on it. Everything will work out the way it's supposed to. It was also the signaling moment of Baloo having to come to terms with departing and saying goodbye to Mowgli, but also understanding that it was for his best. So that was the movie. Favorite character by far for me is Baloo, because I just didn't even remember how much he loved Mowgli, how selfless he was. For me, it was the fact that Bagheera, I felt, knew Mowgli his whole life, right? He was there always watching over him for 10 plus years. And I genuinely felt it was either that Bagheera gave a lot of like hard love and harsh love, but Mowgli a lot of times was the first one to show up. He showed up for the fight. He was the one that was the first to go into the to confront King Louie. He was willing to do whatever he had to do. And it's not that Bagheera wouldn't do it. Bagheera either was super late, super nonchalant, or like the kid's gonna learn on his own. And it's also like you also have different parenting styles. This really goes back to like how people can perceive. Like, I know there's a lot of people that maybe have parents that kind of come off like Bagheera, like kind of fall and learn your lesson type of thing. I'm not gonna sit there and pick you up, but it doesn't mean that they don't love you as much as Baloo kind of shows love. So people can show love differently, but it doesn't negate the fact that they do love you at the end. So I think that was kind of hard for me to grasp, but my favorite character is Baloo. Number two then would be Bagheera. But I don't know. I feel like, I mean, when Bagheera was called to help, he did come to help. He was just very arrogant in the way that he did it. Very much like, I knew you guys would need my help. And I don't like people like that, because it makes you very hesitant to ever ask for their help again. But I think regardless, Baloo is my favorite character by far. Mowgli is not. He's just annoying. Just a very like hard-headed little kid. But yeah, I think number one, it's Baloo. And I think other than that, no one else really matters to me. Bagheera is cool to me. I just think the longer I ponder on Bagheera, it's like there's certain qualities I know I would get annoyed with Bagheera, but number one for me is Baloo. So also King Louie. I love King Louie, but if we're talking about the live action, he's absolutely everything. In the animated, I just didn't feel like he was as big of a character and a spirit than he was depicted in the live action. So that's why I'm gonna hold off on that. But I would love to know your thoughts down below on who your favorite character was and your just whole assumption and thoughts and everything about The Jungle Book. I did love this movie. Not my favorite. It is something though I would rewatch, maybe with like my kids, not just like by myself. The next movie review we will be doing is a surprise, and that is going to be on Cruella. Cruella that just came out, Vanessa? Yes, but it's not going to be a movie review. It is going to be a video. That's all I'm gonna say. After that, we will then go into the Aristocats, and that's actually my first time ever watching the Aristocats. So you got some things to stay tuned to. So stay tuned. Make sure to subscribe, comment, like, and please share if you know anyone that loves Disney movies and thinks that they would enjoy these movie reviews. But other than that, I will see you guys in my next video. Bye guys.